Eventually. You probably saw me and Aisha just interacting there with no audio, right? Mm. Yeah, but you see how close we are to three today? Mm-hmm. We're getting there better, man. We're going to be on the dotted trade. By the way, you're tuned into Living with Dr. Sparman. And today, last week, we spoke about gynecological cancers, including breast cancer. I'm Dr. Alfred Sparman.
And I am Aisha.
And we have a 1 hour long program here for you today. We're going to try to finish up this gynecological cancer, breast cancer. You see that big C word? Nobody likes to hear it. C, no. It's a bad word. As a matter of fact, a lot of us, we doctors, we overlook the problems or the stress or the psychological issues patients feel and endure and encounter when we tell them that they have cancer. It's a serious thing. Remember last week, Aisha, we talked about you wake up in the morning, that's all you think about.
Yeah. Like, how do you tell someone?
I think that some doctors even, some of us would even make the error of calling you on the phone. Yeah, it's ridiculous.
That's so insensitive.
Yeah, you need to call that patient in. First of all, you tell them, well, listen, the results came back and I'd like to talk to you.
That alone would have me nervous.
I know, but still it's not as harsh, if it's the word. You tell them, listen, hey, you got cancer, man, we got to talk. You see what I mean? Come in, you sit down, you talk to them, or you even could encourage their family member to come in and sit down and you build the stage and tell them what the options are, mm-hmm. and if it's how severe it is, those type of things. I believe that a doctor should be honest, though, with the patient. Some doctors don't tell the patient, oh, you just got a little thing going on. No, I don't know. You tell them, but you just know how to do it.
Mm-hmm. How would you do it?
Like, I would say I'd bring them in with the family and say, well, you know what? The test came back a little abnormal. We got to do a few more tests, right? Some of the cells are abnormal. So let me do a couple of tests and see what it is. But some of the options we have are 1, 2, 3, 4. All right? And I would also
give them a sense of hope.
Not a sense of hope, but really what's happening. What's really happening? Mm-hmm. And say, well, listen, you know, if it's stage one, then it's not as bad as stage two, it's not as bad as stage three or stage four. Those type of things you tell them, you know? Mm-hmm. Because sometimes some cancers are very aggressive and you don't have long. So it's very important for you to, it's nothing like knowledge and sharing of knowledge and information.
Yeah.
So today we talked about breast cancer last week. As a matter of fact, most of last week was about breast cancer. We'll talk about some of the symptoms today and the other gynecological cancers. And then we'll talk about treatment today. But we're going to wrap this thing up today. But don't forget, next Wednesday, we got Dr. Rory Lewis, one of the head orthopedic surgeons in Tennessee. He's going to be on here. And we got Dr. Robert Ross, one of the great retinal surgeons in New Orleans. Both of them going to be on here on Wednesday.
And Dr. Brown here as well. I have to
you
be included
that's
in
That's the
this.
First time you said your last name. Was it that
yes.
by intent or that was accidental? It's
don't,
always
please don't
Aisha.
Yeah, just Aisha. Just forget
but,
I said it.
But where the Brown came from, man? You brought that Brown in.
It came from my father. Let me just say that.
But what I mean is, was that
because
accidental?
Is Dr. Sparman? Is Dr. This? Dr. You know, but I feel left out.
Okay, all right.
So
okay.
It's Dr. Brown now.
All right. And then on Friday now, we're going to be doing LGBT with a Q at the end.
Yes.
You see that? She liked that type of program.
Yes, I love to hear other people's opinions on this, and I have a lot of questions when it comes to LGBTQ.
I'm trying to get a psychologist to be on, too, to see what she thinks about it. You think that's... Oh, you prefer
I mean, no. Opinions are welcome from anybody. I know that, you know, the psychologists might have a very, very, very different view from people that are actually within that community. You know what I mean.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they don't think that you're, like, born that way, no?
Oh, they don't feel that way.
I doubt. I feel like they think it's something mental.
Oh. No, some of them believe that you're born that way, you know.
Oh, really?
Hormonal imbalance. Yeah, some
I would
of
like
them,
to meet one of them.
Yeah, some of them are scientifically inclined, as a matter of fact. You know, we doctors move around a lot of medicines. That's what we do.
Mm-hmm. Boy.
The lawyers move around a lot of words. The accountants and the financial advisors, they move around a lot of numbers.
I know.
You know, what would a carpenter move around?
Wood.
Oh, goodness.
Wood.
Everybody's moving around something, right, Aisha?
Yeah.
But the psychologist, we try to get a psychologist on. And next week going to be Hot Week. Next week is time for celebrity time. So we're going to, all of that stuff, all right? All of that stuff. Now.
Breast
cancer.
LivingWithDrSparman.com. You can watch us live on the Sparman Clinic Instagram page and on the Facebook page. Mm-hmm. And you can go on YouTube and type in Living with Dr. Sparman and you'll see us live.
Yeah.
3 p.m.
3 p.m.
3 p.m.
On top. Hey, we get it better, baby!
Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. And don't forget to like and subscribe to the YouTube channel.
Yes.
Sparman Clinic.
Yes. Subscribe. Of breast cancer, we talked about examination, how you should do it. And I'm not going to go that over today. You could go up on YouTube and punching. It's going to show you, even some people got some videos, how you should do. But look, not everybody trying to be scientists. And specialties. Guy wake up one day and he decide, hey, I'm an electrician. He didn't go to school.
This is something that you just feel in your heart and your soul. Yeah. This is what I am. I don't need to go to school for it.
Yeah.
This is what I want to do.
All right, I'm a mechanic.
A what?
Mechanic.
Oh, a mechanic. You thought you said something else. Yeah, but I was like, what?
but you know,
I definitely can't be a mechanic.
You can't.
I never know what's wrong.
But some people get up and just decide this is what I'm gonna do. Yeah. But go to school, learn some stuff, but it doesn't. They don't actually, I'm sorry. They don't. They just go out there and start doing it.
You just have a knack for it. That's what it is.
So we have a lot of people on the internet that generally just come up and just do stuff and say all kind of stuff. So make sure that everything that you read and so forth is authentic, okay? Must have some type of backing, all right?
Mm.
And by the way, before we talk about the breast stuff, this COVID-19 stuff, man, crazy stuff, huh?
Still, I...
You imagine... Huh?
I still hate that it's around and it's going to be here for so long. I feel like I'm going to be confined in my home for the rest of my life.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Like,
I really feel bad.
Yeah, there's so many people that are coming to Barbados that's been abroad.
Yeah.
I think they brought in like 400 people last week. Yeah. So
that,
I feel
that
like...
came back? They're Bajans.
Yeah.
Oh.
So I feel like it's going to... Well, stay here for a very long time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The traveling, that's my problem. The traveling, nobody could travel. You know what's going to happen this summer?
Nothing.
You ever heard about RV traveling?
No.
Recreation vehicle. On the rise. People are just jumping in. You rent one, take the family, and you're traveling overseas. You just go nearby places and have fun together.
The little island drive. That's what it is.
Not even island. You're going over the water. It's like the U.S. right now. They're talking about how increased how the rental of RV vehicles have been exponentially increased.
Mm.
For the summer, everybody's going to be traveling. No aircraft.
Yeah, but really, keep safe.
Oh,
that's smart.
I feel the pain that people like Delta and American Airlines and all those guys are going through. You know what's it like to keep... an aircraft on any site, you got a yacht, it costs money. An aircraft, You're paying and you're making no money. And you know what I'm thinking about too, Aisha?
What?
The traveling. How are you going to do social distance and you want to do, all right, one-way traffic. You can't have passengers going one way and the other way. They all have to go like one single file, one-way social distancing.
You mean where?
Like, in an aircraft. Let's say you want to travel. In the airport too, but let's say in the aircraft. You got to pass, well, they're going to start filling out from the back, I presume. And coming forward, right?
And everybody can be in.
Right. You got to be like separate 6 feet. Though. So let's say you have a big aircraft right now, Aisha. Three aisles. Well, not two aisles, but three, rows, right? Mm-hmm. No, three columns. Mm-hmm. The row is this way, the column this way, right? Mm-hmm. Am I right?
Well, yes, okay. Sir.
So you have three columns, and let's say you have one person here, one person there, one person there. You need 67% occupancy in an aircraft for it to be profitable. And then when they try to do the social distancing, they only could make the maximum 62%. So it does not make money to fly.
I mean, they dropped prices of flights, right? And people just didn't care. No, that was earlier.
They dropped it.
They dropped prices, and then everybody, it didn't matter, no social distancing, nothing. Everybody was like, what? $50 ticket. I'm gonna go. It's like, damn, I should have gone.
Well, I'll tell you what's gonna happen now.
What?
The flight price is gonna increase 8 times because the guys who are whatever the aircraft is, you can citizen those to make up the money, all that fuel we gotta use, and all the taxiing, and all that price for taxiing, and all that stuff, we're gonna have to 8 times. So, in other words, if it costs normally $700 to fly from here to Miami. 7 minutes 56. It'd be $5,600.
I will not be traveling. No, I would have to be meeting Rihanna at the airport. Sorry.
Is that so?
Yes, or Beyonce, if I have
to do that. Well, the good thing with Beyonce and Rihanna, they got their own aircraft, man. There, you see, they're lucky.
So I'm not traveling at all,
They got their own aircraft, baby. They're on there with their own people around them.
Them can walk about when they want to walk
about. The good, the bad, and the ugly, man. Okay, breast cancer. We talked about you guys, the breast examination and stuff. But some of the symptoms we talked about last week, we talked about the orange peeling.
Yeah, the scaling, crusting.
Discharge.
Brown, you said it was brown.
Yeah. That brown is not a nice color, right?
That's nasty.
Green. Okay, that's
so I get my belly just
I mean, you could understand a white discharge or colorless. Discharge.
I would understand if nothing was coming from it. Okay, I don't want nothing
coming
from it.
How about a red discharge? Bloody, it could be bloody too.
Just take off my boob. just take it. I don't need my boob anymore.
All right, what else you got there?
We have the lump,
Yeah, you have a rash too. What else?
Yeah, it changes in the skin.
And the collar, You got a nipple that is
inverted.
It's black. Yeah, black, and it's starting to be brown. Hey. Something wrong. Or it's brown, or it's gonna be black. Something wrong. And then, of course, it's Audi and it's going inwards. We got a problem. What else you got? Any other?
As Dr. Sparman said, he's not talking about a navel. Let's see. Changing the shape and the size and appearance.
Yeah,
so you have to really look at your boobs on a daily and just make sure they look right.
Right. And what they look like is what they look like when you were younger. You see one start to get extremely big, then the other one say, hey, something is wrong.
When I was
younger.
Both
should grow together.
When I was younger, I didn't have any. So, like, right now, I just take that picture
for
yourself.
But still, even if you have small breasts, you have to know the symmetry and so forth and know what they feel like, all right? So those are some things you look for breasts. And especially if you have a family history of breast cancer and stuff like that, and all those risk factors we talked about, which we wouldn't go into. Mm-hmm. You can find out about them in our last episode, session 6, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Good. What are the symptoms of ovarian? Well, I would like to have a diagram up there, if you don't mind. But I don't want that diagram up there for a long time. I want it just for a short time. Yeah. Open it up a little bit. You see that? Some of the symptoms, guys. Let's look at cervical. You see cervical right there? Uh-huh. You got pelvic pain and pressure. You're getting cervical. Ovarian, You could have pelvic pain and pressure. You're going to have bleeding, vaginal bleeding, or discharge, abdominal discharge. I don't like the word discharge.
Me neither.
Yeah,
you know,
it's grossed out. Yeah, but it's okay. It's life. It's life. We get it too, man. Goodness. Abdominal and back pain only. Well, mostly in the ovarian because it's deep. Remember, we talked about it. Deep inside there, guys. Deep back there. That's why when you get ovarian cancer, man, it shows up very late. Bloating seen in the ovarian cancer. Changes in your bathroom habits. In other words, whatever the tumor is, it's pressing. Remember, cancer is a tumor, right? Cells, replication of cells rapidly. They're growing very, very fast. Press against the bladder, you find you're going to the bathroom very often. Or it press against your bowel, and you find that you got either constipation, or you're changing the bowel size. Instead of a nice, large banana, you get a little small pencil. Or you get some type of pellets. You laugh. It is true. Pellets like a goat and stuff like that. You know the change in the character.
But like a banana?
Who remember? Remind me when I'll come back to that. Maybe when they can see us. Now, here you go. Also, vaginal. You can have vaginal. You can have that. And also cervical, you can have shaving ball habits. Also, you can have itching. Well, vulva is on the outside. You can have itching, change of color, rash, and all that type of stuff. We can take that down. Yes, what you were laughing about? Well, I'm saying the caliber, it could be like this. Most the size of your, when you defecate, it's normally this around this size. It's the size, or somewhere around here or so, of your, the caliber of your feces. And if you see it start to be like a pencil, you know something is obstructing that stuff. Or you find that it start to come in pellets and stuff like that. No, some people don't look back, Aisha. They go to the bathroom, I say to some of my patients, what's the color of your stool? I don't know. I don't look back. How could you not look back?
Maybe you don't want to see it. I mean,
yeah, but you got to wipe yourself.
Yeah.
So in wiping yourself, you have to see what's going on down there.
I don't want to comment on this.
Good.
But I want to
people,
know. A banana-sized poo is not... I think I would be worried about a banana-sized
It's too big.
Yeah, that's kind of big.
But I'm saying some people do that. Some people have big ones like that. Some people have small ones. But I'm just saying the main thing is a change of caliber. You can't have a big human being having a size stool of this size, a caliber this size here. Look at the diameter of this, Aisha. All right, okay. Now, when you go to wipe yourself, you're supposed to be looking back. You look and see what you wipe. Blood? How would you know you're not bleeding in your stool? Remember a lot of colonic cancer, rectal cancer? You get it. And the first sign is bleeding in the stool. So everybody should look back, even when you urinate. Look down and say, if it's clear and transparent, it means that you're drinking enough water. If you see it very, very yellow, or even going to brown, you know you're dehydrated. Look at your body, man. Understand what exits. Even if it's waste matter, understand it. Look at it. If you go in the bathroom and you can't even take the smell of what's going on there, because sometimes blood in your stool cause a real pungent smell.
Mixed in with it?
Yeah, or something. Yeah, because if you're bleeding up here in the stomach, it'll pass down by the time the enzyme digests that blood, it'll be black and tarry. And if it's below, like somewhere in the rectum or this colon, it'll come out as red, bright red blood. So you're able to see these things, man. You look, and then that tarry stool smells real bad. So all of these things. Understand the smell. There we know people who eat meat. They got really smelly type of stool. Well, let's go back to it. It's all right. We vegetarians.
This is very traumatic.
Vegetarians, man. Yeah, meat is something else, you know. And we talked last week actually about how meat, red meat, is associated with all type of cancer.
Yeah.
That and obesity, okay?
Obesity is in everything,
All right, so ovarian cancers, you normally have a little bit of bloating and stuff. We talked about that earlier. And the uterine, mostly a little bleeding. Mm-hmm. Cervical, you could have a little bleeding there too. What, pressure problems? Vaginal pressure problems you feel there. You must know when you're different. That's why I told you guys to look for the normal. You look for the normal, you'll see the abnormal, man. And the vulva is easy to be, not very common, vulva cancer, but it's gonna be right out there. You see rash, you're gonna see all kind of stuff.
Yeah, girls.
Okay, let's go for diagnosis now. I hope that diagram is done.
Yeah.
Okay, goodness. Yeah, we got some engineers that are top notch, man. These guys know what's going on. Mm-hmm. Now, most type of cancers, guys, we need a tissue. You need to make a diagnosis with some type of biopsy. Let's go for the breast, for example. You got a lump in your breast, the first thing you want to do is a mammogram. The mammogram will tell you, oh, there's really a lump. And that's not a lump from some type, because a lot of times when you're having your periods, there's a lump there from the extra release of hormones and stuff. But I tell you what, the mammogram will tell you if there's a mass there, huh? The mammogram.
Yeah.
But also, you can use an ultrasound, which can tell you if there's a mass versus some type of cyst. Because sometimes women get cysts of the breast. Cyst, which means a little pocket of fluid.
Oh, that's what it is. So, like, you can have, like, a cyst in your ovaries.
Yeah, it's the same type of thing. Cyst is just a whole little, a membrane covering a whole set of, think about a nice, you ever had chicken pox?
No.
All right, chicken pox, you have this little raised skin and fluid in there. Good. Hey, don't laugh.
No, I'm not laughing.
Don't be happy about that, man. Because if you didn't get it as a kid, you get it as an adult. And when you get it as an adult, it's worse.
You can't
all over your face, man. It's crazy. Some people die when they get it. When you get it as a kid, it gives you the immunity to prevent it from happening as an adult. If you don't have it, guy's got chicken pox out there, you get it. Man, you could say serious stuff. Anyway, it's like that. A little vesicle, a little skin with a little bit of fluid in there. It's the same thing as cysts. Whereas the lump or the mass is the solid tissue, okay? So, ultrasound, mammogram, but the mold, you can't obviate the physical examining your breasts, all right? Same thing if you got a cervical problem, you go for a pap smear. And Aisha, for a pap smear, women normally should go for a pap smear from what age again?
13 to 15, or you could go from 21 to 65.
Good. 13 to 15 too?
Yeah, that's what I saw. Ooh. I saw that on the internet.
If they're not sexually active?
Yeah, you can still go, because once you can get a period before, you know, so, 21. Oh.
So in other words, 13 to 15, you go get one if you start to have your periods. Mm-hmm. And then you wait again from 21 to 65, right?
Yeah.
All right, from 21 to 65, guys, you need to have pap. Most doctors recommend having a pap smear every 3 years. If you've got an increased risk with family history and all that stuff, you may want to up that to 2 years based on what your doctor would tell you. After 65, if you got risk factors, you had cancer, the breast, or cancer of one of the gynecological organs, then you probably should have some more testing done. But that's the guidelines according to the American Breast Cancer Society. Mm-hmm. So, ovarian cancer, if you got problems there, as I said, most times it's late. By the time you find out, it's like pancreatic cancer.
It's bad.
Yeah, you find you got pancreatic cancer, whether it's the head of the pancreas, the body of the pancreas, or the tail of the pancreas. It's kind of late, guys. Pancreas is responsible for, you know, metabolism of sugar. And most diabetics got a problem with their pancreas. Let's just see, they're deep down in there. It's like gallbladder cancer. They're all deep in there. It's hard to pick up. You only start to get symptoms when you got obstruction going on. So, Ovarian cancer, if you feel you got this stuff and you got a family history, you think this happened, you have a little bit of bleeding, the doctors could do some tests like a CAT scan or so and see if there's something
going on. I feel like women would be so scared to find out. Like, you know, when you can tell when something's wrong, but you're so scared to find out exactly what it is. Yeah, God, I'm sorry, people.
But what do you think the rationale about not knowing?
I know, but people have their fears. You know what I mean?
So you could,
I would be scared. I would go. But go. I mean, some people be like, all right.
So you could relate to somebody, they got a family history of a certain type of illness. Let's say ovarian cancer, and they're bleeding, spotting bleeding, right? In other words, they're outside the menses. You could rationalize or try to reason or understand the reason behind someone saying, hey, I don't want to know.
Yeah. I mean, like, they might delay the, you know, the appointment to go check it out. Because, you know, obviously you're going to be scared. Yeah, when I find this out, my life is going to change. Like, if this is the case, this is what I'm going to have to change. This is what's going to change about my body if it's this bad. You start overthinking. You start stressing some more. Yeah.
But then what about an early diagnosis and probably cure or probably...
I mean, I get it, you know. I get it from both sides. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't wait.
You wouldn't wait?
No. No, I definitely wouldn't.
You take a couple of tablets Xanax and just go.
I'm going.
Or some type of chilling out tablet, right?
Yep. Yeah, I'd be like, all right, I'm calm now. Tell me what it is.
All right, CAT scan or so, or they can even do MRI or so to see. Of course, it's deep to see what's going on. Ultrasound normally is not as... You don't get a high yield as a CAT scan. And then let's go on to things like the uterus. You do biopsy. Biopsy, man, a piece of tissue. Piece of tissue is always important. They can go right, like when they're doing a DNC. Dilatation and curettage. We had to put a little stuff in there and scrape out, you know, when you're bleeding a lot, and scrape out the uterine tissue, the endometrium.
I never heard of that.
Never heard of that. Okay, sorry.
That scraping out part just has me
that area in the womb, there where a lot of blood is building up.
I know that part, but the whole scraping out part,
They put you in the lithotomy position and just give you some relaxing medicine and be able to open the cervix and go and scrape out. Yeah. I know.
I know.
But yes, they'll do that, and that tissue can tell them what to do. Also, as well, the cervix, we talk about pap smear, right? So pap smear is just like a brush. They go in there and get a little piece out with a brush. Brush the cells around there. It's like you guys, you young ladies, going for a cervical, a pap smear. And just stay brushing around, take a little bit. Sometimes a little pinch, you feel a little pinch. And say it off. Come back. You had it?
I'm a female, yes.
Okay. You didn't feel a pinch?
No.
Yes. Well, sometimes a pinch, but some doctors are rough.
Oh, I had a female, and she was dead. I told her, look, girl, you need to chill. I am scared right now. I can't do this. She says, fine. She knows she relaxed me or whatever. Yeah. And it was over in like 2 minutes.
It wasn't a big deal. Mm-mm. I went with my partner and she said, ouch, because this doctor was not as... Yeah, man. Some doctors do have the touch. Some doctors are really kind of...
Yeah.
Know,
the only part I don't like about it is because the tool is so cold. That's That's all. Yeah, yeah. That's all it is. Yeah.
You know, I tell you a story of the dentist. I went to the dentist, right? Just to take out a teeth. A tooth, actually. Sorry. Hey, guys. Sorry about
that. I got a teeth.
Grandma. Yeah, grandma, grandma. One. Just one. Just one right there.
One teeth.
One tooth, man. Don't make that mistake again. But it's not bad, because you can correct yourself.
Yes.
You can hear yourself and correct yourself. Listen, I had a wisdom, man, on the right side. Went to painting like crazy. So I went to the dentist and said, hey, 1 second here. All right.
Peeping at the answer.
Yes, yes. So went to the dentist. Now, what do you think the dentist did? The dentist is going there and say, I got to take it out. You don't need the dent. You don't need the wisdom. You got four of them. 28 plus plus 4, 32. You don't need that bad boy there, man. Take him out. Because we don't really do any work on him. Or it.
I don't want to get to that point where I have to take out my wisdom tooth if I ever have to.
No,
do
but
that.
If it's paining you, they don't do any. If for some reason, I don't know if it has normally get cavities, the shape of it. But anyway, this was bad. And I think the nerves were exposed. So she's going to look at her. Every time she pulls, it breaks. Ouch! That's what she's saying. Oops! I said, and every time she pulls and it breaks, it traumatizes the gum in that area. Second time it happened. Third time it happened. I said, wait a minute, man.
Oh, this is purpose work now.
If you do that one more time, I'll put you in this chair and take out your wisdom tooth. I did that. Listen, listen, the next pull, the whole thing came out.
Oh, lucky boy, lucky.
I never went back. But some doctors don't know.
They probably get so tired of doing it, they're like, Jesus, another one.
I think she was nervous because I was a doctor also. You know, doing it on the doctors, yeah.
You'd know.
I think she was nervous, yeah. But they only have the mouth, man, the dentist. You guys only look all your years. You're just doing mouth stuff, man. You should know that thing. Stone cold. We got to do head. We got to do eyes. We got to do neck. We got to all organs in the chest. We got to do pelvis. We got to do lower extremities. We got to do upper extremities. All of that stuff. You guys just got mouth to do, man. You should, 1, 2, 3. And every time we go to the dentist, we worried about sticking you. And there's a needle, man. Take some local lidocaine, rub it in the patient's mouth, numb the surface outside there, and go back in there, and you just, and then you inject. You don't feel a thing. That's an art. But I got a problem. Well, we all have problems with dentists and stuff, but you know, it's all right.
It's
okay. Don't worry about it. Listen, the cervix. So pap smear. That's what we're talking about. And if they find there's an abnormality, don't forget we said HPV, human papillomavirus, is the number one cause of cancer in the cervix. That is why boys and girls between the age of 10 and 26, they can give you that vaccine to prevent you from having cancer of the penis, the throat, and the cervix. When you're older, you should do it now. Encourage all your children, your boys, to do it.
Mm-hmm, the boys especially.
No. And the girls. But, yeah, why especially the boys? Girls get cervical cancer, man. That's more common than penile cancer and throat cancer.
Yeah, but the boys, the boys is be everywhere. So they're going to give it to the girl.
All right. I see where you're going.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
So HPV, man, if they find out that you got abnormal cells, they'll send now, do a test to see if you got HPV. Type 16 and 18 is the one associated with cancer, we said, and type 6 and 11 associated with warts. And the vagina, the same thing, not very common, but if you got vaginal cancer, do a biopsy, you take a piece out. Say it up there, see if it's cancer. Vulvar cancer on the outside. Take a piece out. So biopsy, gold standard to find out. If you have cancer, of course, the cells will be abnormal, right? All kind of stuff going on in the cells that were not supposed to be there. Different type of cell morphology. Not like the normal cells. So once they find out you have cancer, they have to decide if the cancer is localized or if the cancer has gone somewhere else. That's why they have stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. Some people, some classification, have stage 0 also. And stage 4 is the bad one. Remember I told you last week I said that the cancer cells are multiplying so rapidly, and they're immature cells.
Yeah, so
they
can't
hold on properly, and they get loose up into your bloodstreams and your lymphatics,
and go
to your bones and all these other places.
Yeah.
Because they're loose from where they are, the primary cancer, whether it's in the ovaries, in the wherever, and go to the liver, go to the brain, go to the bone, whatever. The loose off goes into these flowing bloodstreams or lymphatics. And that's when it goes to a different organ, it's stage 4. And that's a very low prognosis. Very, very, very low prognosis. Dire prognosis.
Right.
Once you stage it now, you can decide what type of treatment.
The treatment. Dr. Sparman, tell me the treatment.
Yeah. So some, and we're encompassing all of these cancers. Let's talk about the breast. Breast cancers, gotcha. Remember we talked about the BRCA1, BRCA2. We're not going to talk much about that, but those people who've got mutated BRCA1 and BRCA2 got a problem there. You need to know, okay? Because that's, if it's mutated, then it's a very aggressive cancer. However, they look for estrogen or progesterone receptors, ER, estrogen receptors, or PR, progesterone receptors. If you have these receptor positive, it means that you respond to certain type of therapy, hormonal therapy, yeah? And then there's something called HER2, which is another subset. There is a HER gene they look for. And if you're positive human, epithelial growth factor, receptor 2. That's what HER2, just remember that. And if you positive or negative, they can treat you accordingly. So, you can either have the surgery if it's localized, if you got breast cancer. Cancer of your breast, and it's stage 1, or possible stage 2. You mean the treatment of choice may be just surgery. I have had a patient who presented to me at least 20 years ago, maybe 15 years ago.
I was saying that's most of my life right
now. Yeah, 15 years ago, and she said, because I've seen so many people with breast cancer, and they go to the doctor and they say about a lumpectomy, where they take a piece of the cancer, take the cancer off with a margin, they cut around the margin, say, we got it. And I see a lot of those people come back 3 years later with the cancer all over their body in their lung, and they die. I see it over and over again.
And as they say, a piece?
Yeah.
In
other words, if this is the cancer, they cut around here. Take that out and leave that breast in place. They say, we got the cancer because the test, your auxiliary area or your armpit, didn't find any cancer there. Did some CAT scan, bone scan and stuff like that to see if it's gone somewhere else. Nothing. Mm-hmm. So they say, I just think you'll be okay. Not a good thing. I told this lady, after I've seen a lot of people come back, young people. Still remember somebody from St. Vincent came in, young, beautiful lady, man, 33. And had a lumpectomy, and 3 years later she came back full-blown metastatic cancer. So I said to the lady, I says, listen, please, don't do a lumpectomy. Take that whole breast, the whole breast out. She looked at me and she ran away. You know, she was upset because I told her to take her entire breast out.
Whoa.
She never came back to me, Aisha.
It's her boob.
And you know what happened 4 years later?
I saw
her in the arbitraries. Yes, it is true. Listen, guys, listen. My take on this stuff. If you got cancer in your body, take the whole organ out. Don't spare it. Because living, this is a problem as well, actually. Living is better. Oh, boy. Living is better than everything else. Could you help me with this? I'm sorry about that. I was supposed to remember to take that off, but it's we're alive here, guys. We're alive, so that's okay. And the doctor got it. Doctor on call. I'm always on call. Patient calling and stuff.
Yes, we need the doc to survive.
Yeah, but you see, she didn't live. So my point is that you got something in your body, man. Listen, you got breast cancer, please. And the doctor's going to do surgery, you take it out. And some people even go farther, take the other one out. Because you know what? You have an increased risk of breast cancer than in the other breast than everybody else. Too late. Well, I wouldn't say you go that far as Angelina. Take all the breasts out, even though you were... But she had a strong family issue. That's why she did that.
But she had the money to get new boobs. Mm-hmm.
It was done right away, you know.
Like, as soon as she found out?
Yeah. Well, no. When you have the surgeon going to take the breasts off, take all of the tissue and all that, they spare the skin, but they take all the breast tissue out. And at the same time, a plastic surgeon is waiting. He put something in there. So it's one surgery.
Okay. I don't know. Okay, wait. So everything that is in the boob is out.
Yeah. May leave the subcutaneous tissue under the skin, which is a small layer on the skin. They leave that to the extent so everything appears normal. And then they make an incision under there and put in that silicone, man, switch it up together.
Boom. You know what? I got a question.
And you're smoking. What?
I got a question. Okay. So if you have breast cancer, you take out your boobs and everything, and you get pregnant. Right? You know that you're supposed to produce like all the milk and stuff like that. So what happens? Yeah. What happens there?
Like, you never heard about bottle and
no, I know, but like, man,
come on,
what's
man.
Early though?
Those people who would have implantation of breast implants, they don't give when they have babies, man, they get, hey, sorry, you got to use that milk. What is the name of the milk? I forgot the name of the milk.
I don't know.
But whatever the milk is in the bottle, man, they give them that.
Similac,
that's it. Similac, one of our engineers is talking about Similac. He's got a beautiful baby boy. That's not baby boy, he's a young boy.
Big boy.
All right, so here we go. So we're talking about, but to answer your question, yeah, man, at the same time. But you got a problem with your breast, guys. Listen to Dr. Sparman. Take it out. And if you could afford to put one in, fine. If not, you can live longer.
Yeah,
don't allow that because the next time it come up, it's going to be serious. And when it's all the way fluid in your lung, all that stuff you can't breathe is serious stuff.
So
you take a biopsy. That's what they do. They'll take a biopsy of the lump, and it's cancer. They'll check for HER2. They'll check for estrogen receptor. They'll check for PR, progesterone receptors and stuff like that. And based on that, they can give you chemotherapy versus radiation therapy, versus hormonal therapy, all these therapy, and basically all of the other cancers. The cervix, the vagina, the vulva, the uterus, they're treated almost the same thing. Maybe the chemotherapy may change a little bit, but some of are more specific for certain types of cancer, but generally, that's how they go about this thing. Surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, or hormonal therapy.
Chemotherapy is a very dangerous thing to do, though.
What, the hormonal?
The chemo.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. You know what happens, man?
It's like a 50-50% chance?
Well, no, I think it's even more than that in some cancers, because basically, with chemotherapy, it doesn't only attack the fast-growing cells, like the cancer cells. It damages your normal cells, too.
Yeah, that's why people get so, like,
dark and small. Oh, my God.
Pale-looking.
Not easy. And sometimes dark-looking, too. It's not easy, guys. Cancer is not a good thing. Not an easy thing. And that's why it's good to reduce your risk. And you guys, we always try to say that you should... And people who are diabetic, you have an increased risk of all type of cancers. All types. Diabetics. Cancer like sugar. It does. So you got to try to find ways of getting that sugar down in your blood. That's why diabetics don't live very long. If the sugar and diabetes don't get you, cancer will. It's a serious thing. And that's why I even tell some of my kids, I said, listen, cut back on the sugar. Even though you don't have a sugar problem, your pancreas is working fine, cut back on the sugar.
Just
cancer like sugar.
Boy, I love sugar too.
Everybody tastes good. The things that are good for you don't taste as good.
No, they don't. No, they don't.
And all the bad things, man, oh, you can indulge with a nice cheesecake.
Why eat chocolate for dinner?
Yeah, I'm trying to enjoy this. A nice cassava pone, you know?
Cassava pone.
You don't like that?
No, I used to when I was younger, but that just changed. Yeah. It tastes different.
Oh, man, I used to go into the store, guys, and I used to eat that cassava pone. By the time I get to the cashier, you have just the cover. The plastic stuff. Yeah. I'm chewing and buying stuff. Six! One, just like that. And I've changed my diet because, as I said, I plan to live forever, man. I ain't going nowhere. When the Grim Reaper comes, I gonna say, hey.
Not today. Today's not my day. Later on.
But, you know, we can do the best we can. So that is why I always say stay close to the plant. And don't forget, guys, the Doc's Cocktail. For you diabetics, you should take, look up Dr. Sparman's Cocktail. You take 3 apples and you mince that up in your mixer. Well, you got a ninja. Whatever you got, your mixer. 2 large carrots, 3 cups of water, 2 spoons of flax seeds. And you put 1 banana in there. You mix that bad boy up and keep it in your refrigerator. And you could, when you get up at night, you could take that snack instead of the burger or the chocolate in the refrigerator at night or the cheese. You can take a glass of that. It fills you up. It's all about fooling the brain, you know. You drink a glass of that, it fills you up. You go back to sleep. And your sugar levels are normal. Next morning, it doesn't increase because that increased fiber fools the brain. Insulin is released and put a lot of that sugar into cells out of the blood. Guys, I've been using that in a lot of my patients. It works. Don't forget Dr. Sparman's Cocktail. Whew, we about to wrap this thing up. Did I miss anything, Aisha?
Let's see. Did we talk about uterine cancer? We talk about the risk factors for that, prevention for all of those things, breast cancer, all that.
Okay, so.
Pap smear,
we talk about all that stuff. So it means coming up next Wednesday, Dr. Rory Lewis and Dr. Robert Ross. And on Friday, we have the ladies. We try to get a guy here.
I'm trying.
Yeah, try to get a guy.
Trying. The girls are more open to it than the guys.
Man, if you're bisexual, you don't want to talk about it?
Because bi guys get judged all the time.
Yeah.
Yes, they can't live.
But you don't think they're poisoning our woman? All right, I stop. Don't answer that. But man, goodness gracious. We need, all right. We're going to have some good, and next week, big time, next week. Don't forget, as I say, guys, this is Dr. Alvin Sparman. Me and Aisha, we about to get out of here. It was nice spending time with you. We love you. We care for you. Like us and subscribe
to the Sparman Clinic YouTube channel. And we're always going to be live there Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. We're going to be live on Facebook at Sparman Clinic. And we're also going to be live on Instagram.
Yes. So say your prayers.
Take your vitamins.
Yeah.
Stay healthy.
Yeah, that's it. All of that too. And listen, we'll see you on Wednesday.